The atmosphere appeared cordial enough. But leaked evidence shows what David Miliband actually thought of the Sri Lankan government. He said they were liars. His words were reported in this secret cable from the US Embassy in Colombo to the US State Department in Washington. His comment was undiplomatic, but the evidence suggests accurate. And that lying, he now implies, had a calculated purpose.
There was a propaganda battle clearly taking place in which it was very important for the Rajapaksa government to insist on the whiter-than-white nature of its own approach in order to get through this final phase, the final weeks or ultimately days of the war.
The Sri Lankan government was prepared to tell the world whatever it took, no matter how outrageous, to buy time to physically finish off the LTTE and continue, as the evidence suggests, the premeditated targeting of Tamil civilians. Sir John Holmes, here meeting President Rajapaksa in Colombo, was the head of the UN's humanitarian operations at the time.
The accusation against the UN and against the international community is that basically the Rajapaksa regime ran rings around you. It gave you assurances that weren't true, it told you barefaced lies, and continued on doing what it was doing.
Well, I think that's largely true, that they did make promises which they didn't keep, and they did do what they intended to do all the way through, which is to finish the LTTE off militarily, no matter what it cost, including in civilian lives. They didn't believe that anybody in the international community was prepared to stop them, and they were right.
Even where there was sympathy for the beleaguered Tamil civilians, in a world still dominated by the rhetoric of the war on terror, there was apparently no will to do anything for them.
A lot of governments, including the Indian government, because of their own huge Tamil population, wanted to show concern. At the same time, there was a sort of implicit green light for the government to finish off the LTTE.
There were a lot of people, a lot of countries around the world, who were actually probably happy to close their eyes and just have the LTTE dealt with.
There was a bit of a diplomatic dance around all this, with everybody knowing that the end of this was going to be an inevitable military victory of the government and the inevitable defeat of the LTTE, and it was a question of waiting for that to happen, hoping it happened as quickly as possible, and that it happened with as few civilian casualties as possible. Sorry, that may sound a bit cynical, but that's the reality of what I was observing.
Having won its war, the Sri Lankan government warned the rest of the world to stay out of Sri Lanka's affairs. In a keynote speech to the United Nations in New York, President Mahinda Rajapaksa insisted he would deal with things in his own way.
If history has taught us one thing, it is that impose external solutions breed resentment and ultimately fail. Ours, by contrast, is a homegrown process.
Rajapaksa, however, was quite happy to seek an external helping hand when it came to ramming home his message, as this secretly recorded conversation with an executive of the British public relations company Bell Pottinger reveals.
We had a team working in the president's office, and I mean, we wrote President Rajapaksa's speech to the UN last year, which was very well received.
That speech by President Rajapaksa was the prelude to a huge propaganda offensive designed to buy off international criticism. When our last film, Sri Lanka's Killing Fields, was shown around the world, the Sri Lankan government produced its own documentary in reply, an hour-long production called Lies Agreed Upon.
Doctored footage and deliberate lies are presented as authentic. Numbers are pulled from thin air and presented as fact. Sources are not mentioned, faces hidden, voices distorted.
A key element of this film was an attempt to discredit the harrowing testimony of the government doctors who had tried to tell the world what was happening in the war zone. The Sri Lankan government's film claimed the doctors had been forced to exaggerate the death toll by the Tigers and showed footage from a press conference after the end of the war at which they apparently publicly recanted.
They're now free to talk. Let's listen.
Yeah, we were in the LTT control area. When the LTT told like that, we have to tell, we have to do. Sometimes they are coming with a list of numbers, casualty numbers and death numbers. They asked to give the details. Not only me, myself.
So how did the doctors come to make those statements? This US cable gives a clue. It reveals that after the war, the doctors, far from being celebrated as freed hostages, were arrested and
held by the Criminal Investigation Division in Colombo under detention orders.
We've now obtained an eyewitness account of what happened there. The doctors were told that if they did not recant, they would be imprisoned under Sri Lanka's Prevention of Terrorism Act for 18 months, then tried and jailed for several years. They were then told what questions they would be asked by planted state journalists and coached in what to say in reply. After the press conference, the doctors were taken back into custody for several weeks. Alongside that suppression of critics at home has been a drive to discredit critics overseas, something our own team experienced when they were confronted by pro-government Sri Lankan media, including President Rajapaksa's personal media advisor, at last year's Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting in Australia.
It's absolute distortion. It's a disgrace to journalism. It's unethical.
Are you disputing that the video is real?
Of course I'm disputing. I'm disputing everything. You put people in shadow, right? And you say...
Of course you put people in shadow. They're frightened for their lives.
Come on. Are you real? Anyway, are you for real?
In fact, the threat to anyone who criticizes the government is very real, as this exiled Sinhalese journalist knows only too well.
If you really want to discuss the controversial issues, either you have to do it by taking the risk of getting killed or being put in jail, or you will be forced out of the country, because up till now, more than 60 journalists, Sinhalese and Tamils, have left the country. Since 2005 December, more than 26 media workers have been killed.
And in the Tamil homelands of the north and east of Sri Lanka, Tamils are being brutally repressed too. Many are still denied access to their homes, and the military have commandeered land and dominate the economy.
Even though we call it a post-war situation, the war policy still continues. And the war policy is to destroy the national life of the Tamil people, to militarize the Tamil areas fully, to make sure that no resistance would come against the government anymore.
The Rajapaksa regime has always insisted that the findings of the Lessons Learnt and Reconciliation Commission, appointed by the president himself, should be enough to satisfy international criticism. It has not done so. Although the commission did concede that considerable numbers of civilians died, humanitarian aid was in short supply, and that many had disappeared, it exonerated the government of blame. It also avoided a decision on the video evidence of executions, and failed even to mention specific incidents such as the killing of Prabhakaran's 12-year-old son. At no point did it address the issue of command responsibility for war crimes, including those we have detailed in this film.
The Sri Lankan government said that the Lessons Learned and Reconciliation Commission would satisfy international concerns. Has it?
I don't believe that it has, either in its genesis or in its composition or in its conclusions. It's not good enough to satisfy what the UN Secretary General, as well as myself and others, have asked for, which is the independent assessment of the allegations.
The Sri Lankan government made a promise to the international community that it would investigate what had happened in the final stages of the war, that the LLRC would be the venue, the forum, through which it would investigate these serious allegations. And now, with the LLRC's final report out, we find that the Sri Lankan government did no such thing.
Combat operations in this awful bloody war finally ended in May 2009. No one knows exactly how many died in this desecrated landscape. But we do know some of the men who are responsible. President Rajapaksa and his brother Gotabaya remain in power. The men who led the bloody assault on the no-fire zone at Putamatalan have been rewarded with prime diplomatic